So I'd like to not only thank the organizers for such a wonderful session, but also to heartily congratulate them for doing it for 5 consecutive years. And it is such a pleasure and privilege to be here amongst you and be able to share what work we are doing at Twello. So over the next 20 minutes or so, I shall take you through this presentation on footwear prescriptions in patients with diabetic foot. And before I just start with the topic per se, I'll just share a couple of interesting facts that we should be aware when we are managing patients with diabetic foot. So I'm sure all of us here in the audience see a lot of patients with diabetes. And the fact is that 1 in 4 of every patient of diabetes that we see actually lands up with a foot ulcer sometime during the course of their illness. Amongst the patients who actually undergo amputation, about 80% of them have actually had past history of foot ulcer. Diabetes is one of the most common causes of non-traumatic amputation today. Rather, is the most common cause of non-traumatic amputations today. And the most important thing that I'd like to highlight is that up to 85% of these amputations are actually preventable. And the onus of that lies on us as, you know, physicians, surgeons, or medical practitioners, where we can, you know, give an appropriate footwear, manage their diabetes in a better way so that we can prevent an amputation. So if you look at what the data of diabetes foot management in India is, we see, this is data from different centers, but what we see is that those people who actually present with a diabetic foot problem, it's only 40% of them who actually have neuropathy, or maybe around a range of 8 to 20% who have peripheral vascular disease and another 20% have foot deformities. So it's not the usual mindset that, you know, every patient with a diabetic foot ulcer is just neuropathy or vasculopathy. It just contributes to about 40%, 20%. And there are a lot of factors. So whenever in practice we see a patient with a diabetic foot ulcer, we need to evaluate a whole lot of things. Yes, neuropathy is important, peripheral vascular disease is important, deformity is important, but what is also important is to see the footwear. I practice in a place down south where the custom is when the patient walks into the doctor's OP, he'll leave the footwear outside and come. But that's not something that we'd like in a patient with diabetic foot ulcer, because as important it is to examine the neuropathy, the peripheral vascular disease, it's also important to look at the footwear, because many times that's the root cause of the problem. So footwear has to be examined. But when we look back at our medical training, how many of us have actually learned what to look in a footwear and what can we actually examine in a footwear? So for that, we need to know a little bit of something that the cobbler knows probably better, and we need to know the parts of a footwear. There's some things that are really important with respect to diabetes. There's something called as a heel counter. We know that patients with diabetes, if they have posterior column involvement, they have slipping of tuples, and if there is a heel counter, that is something that prevents just getting off the footwear without their knowledge. We also need to know something like a toe cap, because if it's very narrow, we'll see in the subsequent slides what can result out of that. We need to know about the sole, yes, the hardness, toe box, this Achilles notch. You know, some of us, if we've worn jogging shoes, we know that on the back side of the shoe there is a small, you know, curve-like area, and that is basically to give some space for the Achilles tendon, so that when you are moving around, that is giving some support there. So we, as physicians who treat diabetic foot, should be also aware of these parts, because what we actually expect in a diabetic footwear is essentially that we have a footwear that can take even amount of pressure all across the footwear, can reduce any kind of shock and shearing forces that happen during walking, running, some kind of trauma. It can accommodate and stabilize and support some deformities. Many diabetic patients have deformities in the foot, so the footwear should be able to support that rather than making them as predisposed areas for getting ulcerations. And at the end of it, there shouldn't be a very loose footwear that is having extra depth, the insole is not correct, the heel counter that I was mentioning. So all these things should be there ideally in a diabetic footwear. But if I was to put it very simple, the most important thing that the footwear should do is prevent offloading. That is, it should just take the pressure more evenly onto the entire foot rather than just one point, because if it is on one point that we have the entire pressure, that is the area that's going to develop an ulcer. So when we look at a diabetic footwear, so apart from that anatomical description of a footwear, I should ensure that there are no folds, there are no exposed metal. And there's something like, we look at the insole and we say something like a shore value. So what the shore value is something what we measure with a device called a durometer. A durometer is just a handled device that you just press on the sole and you find out how hard is the footwear. We do it for all our patients, and believe me, we've had patients who spent very high amount of money, got the best brand shoes, and you know, when I tell them, look madam, your durometer reading is around 40, normally it should be 15 to 25. No doctor, I spent 5,000, this is hush puppies, this is the best shoe I could have got in the market. But that's not the truth. Because when you look at a footwear, it can be very hard. And unless you objectively assess it, it's not possible. It's a very cheap device, but really helps us evaluate. It shouldn't be less than 15 as well. We don't want durometer readings less than 15, because it's a very soft footwear, and that also predisposes for another ulcer. So an MCR footwear is something that ideally has all these characteristics of the hardness of the sole. But is that all? So it's just, I mean, as a physician, if I make sure all my patients are on an MCR footwear, is that all that I need to know? The answer is definitely no. There are a lot of other things. So as I mentioned initially, the toe box. So if the toe box is very narrow, what's going to happen? Something like this. There will be some kind of deformities. At the end of it, this area will get ulcerated, and ultimately that will be a cause of amputation in the near future. So we ensure that the toe box is good enough for that particular patient. One size cannot fit all. And if that is not the case, then all these kind of callosities crop in, skin becomes hard, necrosed, and that becomes an ulcer. So the first thing, apart from making sure that the shore value is good, the first thing that we ensure that the toe box is adequate to accommodate all the toes and there's no crippling of toes. What next? Sometimes patients present with these kind of heel ulcers. So this patient is wearing an MCR footwear, but he's got a heel ulcer. So the next thing that I want to see is whether the heel is actually accommodated well or not. So just imagine if this particular heel was coming out, this edge of the footwear would be just nudging onto that skin, and that would result in an ulcer. So the second thing that we have, apart from the toe box, is to look at when the patient wears the footwear, it fits in well with the heel. Any idea what's wrong with this footwear? A foot? It's a little dry skin is there. Maybe a little bit of callosity there. So again, in India, we have a custom of wearing toe rings, and that is something that we do not recommend. It's only after you remove the toe ring do you actually realize there's an ulcer sitting there. So that is also something that is very, very important, that we ensure that our patients don't do. These are the kind of ulcers that develop. They may start small and they may be hidden for a very long time, because these rings are just worn for years after years of whatever custom they follow. But for all diabetic patients, we ensure that there are no toe rings. This is also another MCR footwear, but we are always against T-straps. So something that has a thumb, and that's again something that we don't want. So even though this is an MCR footwear, this thumb would actually again give a lot of pressure, something like a toe ring, and that would also initially begin with, it would be small, but later on this ulcer becomes big. So what we've seen till now is, yes, MCR footwear is important, it has a good show value, but apart from that also we need to look at the footwear in more detail. We need to look at the toe box, we need to see whether the heel is accommodated well, we make sure that there are no rings and there are no, you know, any kind of T-shaped footwear. What's wrong with this foot? So this patient is probably sitting cross-legged, whether he's a BD worker or he's somebody who's a priest who sits in the temple. So this is cross-legged sitting. So whenever a patient sits cross-legged for a very long time, we tend to see ulcers on the lateral aspect. And again, the footwear needs to be modified. You know, either we get some kind of a support so that this area does not touch the ground, or sometimes, you know, the strap has to be adjusted in a way. So that's also something that we need to look at in a footwear. So till now, we realize that MCR is important, but apart from MCR, we look at other things as well. And that's in a patient who has no foot ulcer. But what happens when a patient comes to you with foot ulcer? What kind of footwear do you actually prescribe? And the one main thing that I would say is offloading. maybe no antibiotic creams, no oral dose of antibiotics, no kind of big betadine ointments actually ever heal a foot ulcer. Unless there is infection, there is no role of any kind of oral antibiotics, and topical antibiotics and topical antiseptics are an absolute no. What we use is only saline. Believe me, what heals the ulcer is only offloading. The classical example that I tell all my patients is, if you have a hurt in your hand and you keep 70 kg weight on it and make sure you rub it 5 times a second or 5 times a minute, how on earth would you expect that to heal? And that's the same thing what's happening in the foot. So you have a foot and you have a plantar ulcer and you're putting your whole body weight on that, and that's rubbing on and off every time with your footwear, that will never heal. So it was Archimedes who actually said that, you know, if you give me a kind of a place to stand and give me a lever, I can just move the whole earth. So he can offload the earth. So how do we decide on offloading? I'm sure a lot of us would have seen these kind of scanners, which are actually quite well marketed, but they do tell us some kind of high pressure areas, but they're not really the best. And why are they not the best? Because these scanners are just measuring static pressures. But the patients are not static all the time. Patients are moving all the time. And so what we use in Vellore is something more dynamic, something called as a Harris map, wherein, you know, the patient walks over a kind of a stamp pad paper and goes. So the pressures are actually determined when the patient is moving. And so these are the pressure areas, and that's how we determine which are the areas in the footwear that we have to scoop out or offload. So what are the different ways of offloading? I'll just show a couple of examples. So this patient, as you see, has an ulcer on the medial aspect, on the plantar aspect, and I want this area not to touch the ground. And so how do we do it? So we take the sole and we scoop out some area there, and we ensure that the other foot has an equal height, there's an equal compensation. And so now when this patient is walking, this area is not getting the pressure, and the pressure is shared by the other normal area. This is something that is called as a clog. Or if a patient has an ulcer on the anterior aspect of the plantar aspect of foot, this is something that is called as a metatarsal bar. A metatarsal bar will just prevent the ulcer touching the sole again if it's in the anterior aspect. We know that most common ulcers are in the anterior aspect of the foot. If you see the epidemiology of foot ulcers, 90% of the ulcers that actually happen in the anterior aspect, and very few of the ulcers actually happen in the hinder. So that's why rocker bottom footwear has come as a very big way in management of diabetes. What exactly is a rocker bottom footwear? Is actually, they have something like an elevation here, so that the anterior aspect or the forefoot actually doesn't touch the ground. And it's mainly the hind and the midfoot which takes the major load of the weight. And these are kind of comfortable shoes. Many times in the market also we see that the shoes are designed in such a way so that the anterior aspect is given the least load. What are the other offloading options? Sometimes crutches. Sometimes, patient cannot just walk and cannot be stable on crutches, especially patients who have long-standing diabetes. Even a wheelchair is a method of offloading. Our main aim is just that the patient should not keep their feet on the floor. Other ways would be total contact cast. I'll show you some examples, bowler iron cast and some of the other examples that I'll show you. So this is a patient who's had a transmetatarsal amputation and has good granulation tissue and wanted to heal. So what I use is a bowler iron. So what the bowler iron is doing is, it is actually something that's going to take the entire pressure from the knee directly to the ground. And the area of the ulcer is just not touching the floor. And what happens in 12 weeks? It's completely healed. Had this ulcer been left alone, very good granulation tissue, but if it's just touching the ground every day, believe me, several months would also pass and the ulcer would never heal. So this is something like a PTB bowler. PTB means patellar tendon bearing bowler. So the whole weight of the body is directly transmitted from the knee to the ground. The only important criteria before I use this is that the patient should have good knee. Patient shouldn't be a patient of osteoarthritis of the knee, because then I'm going to damage the knee alongside. Other ways are, if the knee is not healthy, then we go up to the hip, and directly from the hip we get the pressure down to the ground. Some other modifications are there based on the pressure that is given to the tibia rather than knee. And for those patients who actually have had amputations, we modify and make the shoes in such a way that, you know, again, that ulcer is not touching the sole. When we come to Charcot's foot, again, Charcot's today diabetes stands as number one cause for patients with Charcot's foot. Charcot's is basically, in very simple words, if I have to explain something, a very badly deformed looking foot. If you as a physician look at the foot and you say, oh my God, you'll be in so much pain. And you look at the patient's face, the patient says, no doctor, I have no pain at all. And it's just the way it is. There's so many microfractures inside, it's just becoming a bag of bones. So how do you manage that? The idea is again to reduce the pressure in the areas which are affected. And so what we use, if the Charcot's is not involving any joint, it is called as a stable Charcot's, and then we use something called as a molded insole. And it's molded basically based on the pressure areas, looking at the x-ray where all the microfractures are more, and that's how a more customized footwear is designed. And this is something called a molded insole. But if there is an unstable Charcot's, that is a Charcot's which is involving the joints, and at that point we use something like an AFO or a total contact cast or a pneumatic walker brace. So a total contact cast is nothing but plaster of Paris. It's just something that's put up on the foot, and so that, you know, the patient cannot do anything, he cannot remove it. He needs to just come to the doctor once in 2 weeks, remove it if there's no ulcer. If there's an ulcer, we sometimes make a window over there, but if the patient is not happy with that, then there is something more removable, like an air boot cast or something that is known as crow, that is Charcot restrained orthotic walker. But personally speaking, I'm not so fond of these removable kind of footwears. It's not exactly a footwear removal type of orthotic implants, because, you know, sometimes patients think, okay, I just have to go to the washroom, let me go, you know, without wearing, it's just 2 minutes. And that once in 2 minutes at night sometimes, and so the patient, you know, we've done studies in which we've compared, you know, if there's something more permanent, like a TCC, that is a total contact cast, which the patient cannot remove, the healing is much faster. It is human mentality, you know, if I have something removable, I take things slightly, sometimes at least, and that, you know, the pressure starts happening. The other kind of footwear modifications that we suggest to correct the deformities, these are toe cap, toe prop, and some other things. But at the end of the day, when I'm sitting in a busy OPD and I have a patient who's sitting in front of me and he has a foot ulcer, I have to quickly decide, okay, what is the best footwear for him, so that, you know, I kind of give him a prescription. We are lucky in CMC, we have an orthotic center which is inside the hospital and the footwear is provided by the hospital. But we've had people across the country who send their, you know, even private practitioners who send their cobblers to get trained into making specific diabetic footwear. And believe me, that's something that really helps. So, and I'll call them for all of us to take home to try and understand as to which footwear is actually best in which scenario is something that is there. So if the patient has an ulcer, and as I said, the ulcer is most commonly placed in the anterior aspect of the foot, 90% of the times, and then the best thing is a rocker footwear, because the rocker, I said, the entire pressure is in the middle and the hind aspect. If there's a midfoot or a hind foot ulcer, then we cannot use a rocker, because all the pressure is in the midfoot and hind foot there, and that's when we either use a total contact cast or something like a bowler iron or a PTB. If the patient has had an amputation, the best thing is again surgical shoes, so that we design, because when the amputation is done, where the granulation tissue is there, which is the level of the incision, that has to be customized. It's not that one shoe will fit everybody there. If the patient has Charcot's, we see if the joints are involved or not involved. If the joints are not involved, we see it's stable, and then the molded insole is said to be the best. And if it is unstable, then either we use a TCC, AFO, or a pneumatic boot, or crow. It's not only the shoes, it's also the socks. So there's enough and more data that says that, you know, there shouldn't be nylon socks that we suggest our diabetic patients to wear, because cotton and wool socks actually breathe, and, you know, there's good transmission of air. Socks should not be wrinkled, you know, because if there's wrinkling, they become pressure areas. They'll be as damaging as a bad footwear. And that's also something that we need to see. And especially some of the new socks would be very tight. So that's also not good, because anyhow, patient will have some peripheral vascular disease component with this tightness there. This ischemia will worsen. So at the end of the visit of a patient to your clinic, if you have to, educate the patient and send him back, the first and the most important dictum is never walk barefoot. You know, whether it is a temple or where, so I know at places in temples you cannot wear footwear, so either patients wear socks and put some kind of a sole with inside the socks, or whatever they do, but the golden rule is they cannot walk barefoot, whether they are inside the house or outside the house. With the foot ulcers, we tell our patients they are common, but the more important message that we need to give is they are preventable. A good and expensive comfy footwear is not always the best. It's best to actually get it checked and make sure that what you're wearing is good. And apart from just ensuring that it's just a simple MCR, there are a lot of other things that we need to look as well. I mentioned about the toe box, the heel. We looked at no toe rings, the T-shaped, and straps. Offloading is the key when there is an ulcer, so we don't want that ulcer to touch on the ground, and just give it 6 to 8 weeks and you see remarkable improvement. Wear clean, soft cotton socks, just not tight, and ensure that you never have wrinkles when you wear socks. Wear properly fitting, well cushioned shoes, and some people say, "Look, I don't wear sandals, so you're giving me MCR sandals." So we give them MCR sole so that they can put the soles inside their normal shoes and still use make use of MCR. Many times, most of the new ulcers break in whenever they buy a new shoe. I'm sure all of us in this room have bought new shoes and have had shoe bites. So imagine a patient with diabetes, with neuropathy having a shoe bite, how much time it will take to heal. So whenever there's new shoes, practice for it half an hour every day and then only go on using it long times. Patients with nephropathy, they rarely have dependent edema by evening. Morning when they go to office, the edema is hardly there. By the time the whole day they're sitting and they're coming back, it's almost a difference of a size. So sometimes we've had patients who've taken 7 number in the morning, and when they're coming back from office, they wear 8 number and come back, and it works. We should always ensure if you're using any kind of a removable kind of a footwear, it should not be a replacement for shoes. It's not that they can remove it and sometimes walk without it. And we should schedule regular visits to the diabetic foot care team. So this is our team in Vellore. We are lucky to have this department which actually makes these customized footwear, but we are happy to train people who come from outside.